down, I will welcome you. This is the annual meeting of the UIC chapter of SUAA, and we are very fortunate today to have our Chancellor, Michael Amiridis, who will be talking about you and UIC. So, as you know, the Chancellor came just over a year ago. I'm sure it's been an interesting year for him. I wonder if it came out the way he thought it would. We'll see. Before he was here, the Chancellor was provost at University of South Carolina at Columbia, another large and complex university system. By professional training, he is a chemical engineer and was a department head at University of South Carolina. He received his PhD from the University of Wisconsin-Madison, so he's coming back to the Midwest, and originally he's from Greece. So it's my pleasure to introduce you, and I've just been handed some little bit of history. As you know, the organization is current employees, but also retired members. And Jim Limber thought you might like to have this. October 1st, 1991, preparing UIC for the 21st century. We'll see, you can see what they had. And then Chicago Illini News and trustees plan to build south of Roosevelt Road. So this is something for you to take.
Thank you.
Help.
We're still paying for that part of the campus, by the way.
So it's my pleasure to introduce the Chancellor.
Good morning.
Good morning. Thank you.
It's a pleasure to be invited to spend a few minutes with you today. You know, you get an invitation like this and you ask, what do you want to say? What should I focus on? They say, oh, we have a title for you. The title will be You and UIC. I thought, okay, that's pretty good, it's very generic, I can say whatever I want about UIC and you. But thinking a little bit more about who you are and what would the title represent, I thought we could tweak it a little bit, and instead of saying you and UIC, we can call it you are UIC, or even better, you are still UIC, and I think you are still UIC hits the tone right. Because you have been part of the family for a long period of time, you're still part of the family, and you're here today. You're still here today. So it feels almost like it's kind of Hotel California. You can check out, but you can never leave. You prove the point by being here. And I think it's important that to realize and recognize that nobody can advocate better for the university from this group, because you know the university very well and you care about the university. If you didn't care about the university, you wouldn't be here today. I believe that the goals of UIC, whether it was 1991, 25 years ago, and by the way, 1991 is the year that I graduated from the University of Wisconsin, are your goals, and I hope that you will adopt them and you will be able to serve our vocal, as our vocal and passionate spokespeople out in the community. I realized that it was not a tradition of this campus to have a State of the University address. Of course, you know, with our system, the way that the system operates, it becomes a little bit tricky. You say State of the University, who is the university, what is the campus, and should be State of the Campus address, but I don't like State of the Campus because we are a university. So at the end, we found a compromise and we ended up calling it the State of the University of Illinois at Chicago. And that's what we did this year. And it was a very good response. It was, I was very surprised. There were more than 500 people that came to listen to this, and many of them watched it online. So I suspect that maybe a few of you were there, maybe not. But I thought that I would give you an executive summary of it today. So let you know where we are right now with UIC. Those of you who have already heard it, check out. for a few minutes, and then we'll come back and they'll give you a chance to ask questions if you have any. I started a year ago, almost a year ago. It was March 16th of 2015. And one of the first things that I did was early in the morning, 6 o'clock, I went to the change of shift on my first day in the facilities, the maintenance crew. And I went taking to them Greek pastry and coffee. Always food helps with diplomacy. But I wanted to meet with this group first because I wanted to thank them for the job that they do to keep the campus in good shape, especially under difficult weather conditions. And I've heard from quite a few people now that I should be very grateful for the winter that we had this year. But please remember that for me and my wife, having spent 21 years in South Carolina, this was the worst winter that we have faced in the last 21 years by far. So this is a matter of perspective of what is mild and what is not. Interestingly enough, during my visit, Mr. Donovan had arranged for the crews, the facilities crew, to give me a golden shovel. Right? I didn't understand how prophetic this was and how symbolic this shovel would become during the last year. Because as we have seen in over a year now, I need more than a shovel, a really big one, to dig out of the state budget mess that we have been in. And I'll talk to you about the budget and what the action that was taken last week means. That same day, I had a lunch with the leaders of the student groups on campus. And what I told them the very first day that I met with the students was that the experience and the success of our students will always be at the top of the priority list for the university. I also talked to them about the significant advantages of a research university. Why is it important to be even an undergraduate student at a research university? The unique opportunities that, in my opinion, exist for them and for the university in the city of Chicago, and then the need for this university to become more innovative, more entrepreneurial, and more nimble in the way that we are running our business. 1 year later, I think that we can reflect on what has been accomplished during the past year, review some of the challenges that continue to confront us, and outline a vision for creating a better and stronger university. I really believe that there is a lot to be proud of at UIC. There is much to be daunted by, and there's a lot to be excited about. I'm confident now, after a year here, that this is a great institution, and we are on the road to become the model urban public research university for this century. It's interesting to see 1991 talking about designing the university for the 21st century. So during the last year, a number of things have been accomplished, including, in my opinion, the very important recruitment of two outstanding leaders on campus. We hired a new Vice Chancellor for Health Affairs, Bob Berries, who joined us in January, and we hired a new Provost, Susan Poser, who joined us in February, so they came in with a month difference. In a very short period of time, both of them have made their presence known on campus, and I'm really confident that we are very fortunate to have them on our team, and the leadership team is gelling, is working very, very well together. With Bob's arrival, we also realigned all parts of the health sciences enterprise, including the hospital, under the UIC organizational umbrella, and we have developed new co-branding standards to reinforce that we are all one campus flying under one banner, the UIC banner. It made no sense. It really made no sense to have the west side of campus and pieces of the west side of campus separate from the university and reporting to the system down in Urbana. And I'm glad that we have accomplished this, and in fact, we are co-branding every part of the UI Health, and Bob and Susan are working very close together to ensure that the new structure enhances our operations and makes the whole university more cohesive and stronger. I keep talking about one university. We are one university. This year, we have demonstrated the strength of the reputation of UIC by attracting record number of students during the worst crisis faced by Illinois' higher education in recent decades. We reached an all-time record enrollment of over 29,000 students in the fall of 2015. And if everything goes as planned, and with the numbers, it's still a very fluid situation. It's the last week before the students commit for the fall. If everything goes as planned, I expect that we are going to break this record again next fall. This number speaks volumes of the quality of our undergraduate, graduate, and professional programs. Students are very, very educated consumers. They don't just walk somewhere because it's closed anymore. They have many choices and they know that. And no one really likes to talk about rankings unless it's good news, and then you can't stop us from talking about rankings. But the good news actually is that US News rankings moved our undergraduate programs 20 spots up, and we were ranked last year number 62 among all public universities in the country. 7 of our graduate and professional programs are ranked in the top 10, and 27 of them are ranked in the top 50. So quality is here. Also, for the first time, we threw a party for over 1,100 graduates in December. We call this party a commencement. We didn't have a commencement in December. And I expect that this new university-wide December tradition will continue to provide students and their families with an opportunity to celebrate their success, something that many of them were deprived from because they couldn't come back in May, 6 months later. You know, life happens after you graduate. At the same time, I think it builds goodwill among our alumni by doing so. One of the clear, obvious to me, signs that I saw on campus was also that we need more of a school spirit. I walk across campus and I frequently see students, undergraduate students, walking around with two t-shirts or sweatshirts with another institution's name on it. At my former institution, at the University of South Carolina, this would be grounds for immediate dismissal and you wouldn't be readmitted until you plead guilty and you come and beg. Right? We don't have the school spirit here that we should have. We don't have the pride on this university that we should have among our students. And I think our athletic department can play a bigger role in this area by helping us build important student traditions. Winning a few games also is going to help along these lines. But I am impressed by our student athletes and coaches, not only of what they do in the courts and the fields of play, but also because of their engagement in and around campus. And I think you see that the basketball team, they were there to help during moving day. The women's soccer team was there. These kids are engaged. They are truly student athletes. They are not minor league pros that you see in many other institutions, to remain nameless. Access and affordability have been key priorities during this year, and they will always remain key priorities for this institution. Speaking first about access, we implemented a change in our undergraduate admission criteria this year, recognizing that performance and rank in high school are more important than the results of the standardized tests. And there is correlations in research that has been done nationally to show that you correlate with rank in high school, the graduation success, much better than we can correlate it with standardized tests. With this change, we hope to bring to campus an even more diverse freshman class this year, especially in terms of African American students, since for many Chicago public schools, we were not admitting the valedictorian from this school because of standardized tests. And in terms of African American students, this is an area where our demographics do not adequately reflect the makeup of Chicago, and we need to change this. We held a news conference with the mayor to announce the UIC Star Scholar Program in the Daily Library last August, and we secured a rather rare favorable editorial from the Chicago Tribune on September 1, 2015. We had another favorable story a few weeks ago. Maybe this will become a habit by now, because I understand that the tradition of the habit is the other way around. In fact, the first favorable editorial that we got from the Tribune, people were worried that something has happened to the regular writers. And now it's the interns that they're writing at the Tribune. Despite the tremendous financial pressure that we are facing, now coming to the affordability side, we decided to keep in-state undergraduate tuition and fees flat for this coming year. We made this recommendation to the board from UIC, and the board agreed to that. And this is the second year in a row for tuition, because we understand the difficulties faced by many of our students and their families, especially during the current financial situation and the current state environment. One particular highlight from the last 12 months was the trip that we took to the White House last summer, where a UIC delegation had the opportunity to meet privately with President Obama in the Oval Office. In fact, he told me that the office is smaller than what they make it look like in TV. I said, you have a pretty good office, actually. This campus should be proud of the fact that the President and the First Lady personally reviewed our library proposal. The foundation had told me this, but speaking with him in person, I realized that he knows what we put in, and they're highly complimentary of the work that USC did to make a strong case for the presidential library. We left the president with a few USC things, so he has no excuse for not wearing USC logo when he's back in Chicago. Now, joking aside, we have maintained an ongoing dialogue with the Obama Foundation, and we remain hopeful that we would have a significant role in the programming aspects of the Presidential Center, regardless of the location in the South Side. And in fact, even just a few weeks ago, we met with the foundation on this same topic, and the foundation representatives speak publicly about the involvement of UIC, so stay tuned. Moving from the national to the local government level, our efforts to establish a stronger relationship with the city over the last 12 months have also gained some traction. In addition to the MOU with the city colleges, we signed a memorandum of understanding with the city's Department of Planning and Development. And the purpose of this MOU is to align the city's long-term capital improvement investments with those that might occur at the university level over the next 10 years. We were the only university in Chicago that did not have an agreement with the city. I expect that we'll get moving on some capital improvement projects soon, putting this new partnership with the city to the test. During my trips around the city in different neighborhoods, I frequently heard that USC's presence needed to be felt more strongly, especially in neighborhoods that have so much need, West Side, South Side. One attempt to respond to these requests is the newly launched USC Engage program. This is led by our Dean of Education, Dean Alfred Tatum, and we have student volunteers that have started working this spring at six Chicago public schools and community faith centers on the west side of Chicago to provide after-school mentoring and support in writing and math to middle school students. We plan to expand to even more sites next fall, and everything that I know shows that this has been a great success. We have served over 100 middle school students through this program, and we plan to expand. In the same spirit, we're also looking at opportunities to expand the healthcare delivery efforts into additional medically underserved areas. As you probably know, we have 13 miles square community health center sites, which include primary care clinics, school-based clinics, nurse-led integrated health clinics, and they are already serving patients regardless of their ability to pay in many communities across the city. Miles square sites have seen 35% growth in the number of patients served in the last 3 years, and we are committed to continuing along these lines and trajectory. In fact, UI Health Services will be expanded into Pilsen this summer and early next fall with a physical location there. I understand we're like the Cleveland Browns, we left in the middle of, or maybe the Colts, we left in the Baltimore Colts, we left in the middle of the night, but now we're returning to Pilsen with a lot of music and celebration around it. Having an integrated delivery system that includes a network of FQHCs, as they call them, the federally qualified health centers in the community, offers really the convenience and access that these communities need, and it's not matched by any healthcare system in the city of Chicago. It reflects our commitment to health equity citywide. So with these two examples, what I wanted to do was to demonstrate our commitment to community engagement and the improvement of the lives of people around us. We are one of the most engaged public research universities in the world. So that's what some of the things, a summary of what has happened over the past year. Now, looking forward, more important, into the future, we will continue to tackle major issues associated with the student experience and success to begin with. I already had the discussions that we needed to have with our provost, and we exchange ideas about what can we do to improve recruiting, what can we do to improve our international agenda, build a comprehensive research and teaching international agenda? What can we do to innovate in the classroom? New pedagogy, consistent with what this generation needs and wants. What can we do in advisory and mentoring, which is the number one issue from the students right now, advising and mentoring in order to be successful. And the many opportunities that we have never taken advantage of in an urban environment like this one, with millions of people around us, to have a robust summer program, to have a robust evening program on campus, and to have a robust degree completion program for people who have completed part of their education but they have never gotten a degree. These are all ideas that we're going to put into play next year, and I also know that Bob Berries on the west side of campus, he is very passionate about interprofessional education in the health sciences. This is an area that we need to move in, and he is determined to advance UIC as a national leader in interprofessional education. It makes no sense to educate nurses, pharmacists, doctors, dentists separate from each other, and then as soon as they graduate, we say, oh, now you're a team, you have to work together. Our enrollments continue to grow, and as our research enterprise continues to flourish, in fact, it appears that we will have an increase in federal expenditures this year. They represent a great trajectory. But it will be extremely difficult to achieve our educational, research, and engagement goals without a significant upgrade of our capital infrastructure. Our capital infrastructure consists of approximately 15 million square feet of space, 130 buildings, and 250 acres of land, and the average building is 50 years old. It's a little bit younger than I am, only by 3 or 4 years, and if you put 50 years in, you get retired. There is a reason why we're taking these pictures of the UH from far away. Because if you focus in much closer, the picture is not as good as it looks like from far away. It reminds me of my mother. She's 82 years old. Every time that I get a camera out, she says, let me move away. Right? She wants the pictures taken from far away. It should come as no surprise that the dramatic decline in state capital funding over several years has led to a deferred maintenance backlog of approximately $800 million for this campus. We're trying to address the problem. We're putting $30 million a year for renovations and repairs. However, despite the $30 million, the deferred maintenance grows by a rate of 8%. So if you do the math, 8% of 800 million, 64 a year. We're putting 30 to address the issue, we're not catching up. We have a problem. If we're going to break the cycle, because if we had more money to put in, we would have put it in, but we don't. If we're going to break the cycle, we have no choice but to change the financial options for funding capital infrastructure. We will continue to lobby vigorously at Springfield. They still owe us $60 million that they appropriated 12 years ago about the advanced chemical technology building that we haven't seen. And the state this year froze all renovation projects. Dentistry is with a plastic roof for the last year, despite the fact that we have the money and the state owes us some money. So we'll continue to lobby for this. In fact, we will continue to raise hell. And I hope that when you see your representatives, you can ask them, where's the money from UIC? What has happened with the capital projects at UIC? But in spite of this, I think that we need to build what we can with our own funds, and we should do everything that we can to bring private funds to campus. This year we will use our own funds to build the basic sciences labs in the College of Medicine, to modernize some of our classrooms, which is a continuing catch-up process, to complete the Mile Square building, which is shelled, only the two floors are complete, the rest of it is just a shell, to improve the hospital's infrastructure, the hospital is putting money into it, and to construct a modular design engineering lab building on Halsted. We're also moving forward with public-private partnerships, partnerships that will allow us to bring private money on campus to build a new classroom and residence hall building on Halsted, again, between the whole house and engineering. And also, we hope that we are going to get the private money that we need with professional sports associations to build a beautiful new soccer stadium that will continue the transformation of the South Campus. You see what the renderings would look like there. We have made progress in terms of our visibility in Chicago, but there is still a lot of ground to cover. We need to continue to carry our message through a campaign in the media, in civic organizations, and in corporate Chicago, so that this city becomes aware of our work and our success, and recognizes UIC as being Chicago's public research university. And the phrase that I have used frequently is that we may not be the University of Chicago, we are the University for Chicago. Buying the station on Peoria on the L Street is one, buying with a quotation mark, is one of our goals for this year. In essence, you buy all advertising on this stadium, on this station, and you turn it into red and blue, the same way that Loyola has done with their L station. A critical group in this effort, aside from everyone sitting in this room today, are our 170,000 alumni who live and work in this area. 170,000 of them. We recently constituted the Chancellor's Leadership Board, which includes distinguished business and community leaders. It's truly Chicago's A-team in terms of leadership that agreed to serve this university and help me and help the university altogether to identify more opportunities for our students and the faculty in the business community in particular. Now, let's talk a little bit about Springfield, right? The state is struggling with the higher education, what I think at a high level is a higher education paradox. I honestly believe that there is broad consensus, fueled by lessons of our own history, that a college education and a strong university system are critical to the collective prosperity of the state, and I think the lawmakers believe this, they agree to this. But they are challenged to sustain the investments needed in public higher education to support this prosperity, and they are challenged by the financial situation of the state. The state's current budget impasse is of great concern, and Illinois is at a crossroad right now. As I have told legislators repeatedly in the past few months, we are running out of time, and we are facing the consequences, already we are facing the consequences of reputational damage. Reputational damage has been done to this university, to the University of Illinois, to Urbana-Champaign, to the entire higher education system here. The rest of the country knows what's going on in Illinois. And also we are paying significant opportunity costs right now. The developments of last week, what happened in Springfield on Friday, in my opinion, confirms the consensus that exists around higher education, but it doesn't provide a solution. What we had last week was a last-minute measure to avoid disaster. And disaster was closing of campuses. If they hadn't taken action on Friday, Chicago State would be closed. And Northeastern Illinois and Eastern Illinois would follow very quickly. So it's not a solution. It's a last-minute avoid disaster kind of thing. In fact, they extend the uncertainty. By what they did last week, we're trying to decipher what happened. The uncertainty for us is extended because they're not going to do anything for the next 2 or 3 months now. Right? We are not sure if the 27% of our budget that we got is a portion of what we can expect for 2016. We are not sure if the 42% of the MAP grants that they approved is just a portion. We think and we advocate strongly that this is just a portion. But you know, when you move into a new fiscal year, it's very difficult to keep tab of the previous fiscal year as well. If we do not receive full funding for the MAP and a significantly higher portion of our appropriation for 2016, it would be a disaster. It will take years for this campus to recover from a hole that will be created. Just to put things in round numbers, we expected from the state at the beginning of the year somewhere around $250 to $270 million. Cut down 20% of it, $220 million. And what they approved on Friday was somewhere around 70 or 80. So we are down 140 to 150 million. If you think, you work here, you know that we're not having 140 or 150 million stashed away somewhere that we can use in a situation like this. Despite all of this, I believe that UIC is in a strong position, much stronger than any other school in the state of Illinois. I would argue that we are in the same position, actually, that our sister institution, because a lot of people think that our sister institution of Urbana-Champaign is in the strongest position in the state. We are at the same position because of the collective efforts of our people, our students, our faculty and staff, but the absence of a full state budget allocation is severely limiting our ability to move forward. I think that the state has a choice before itself, and I'm sorry to see them kick the can further down, because we need to put them in front of this choice. It's a choice about the importance of higher education. And we need to make our representatives understand that lack of action is de facto a choice against higher education. They choose to be against higher education for the last 10 months, and now they took an action just to avoid disaster. And I hope that doesn't mean that there's not going to be action for another, I don't know, 4, 5, 6 months, 3 months, whatever it is. That's the point that we continue to make, and I hope you will help us to make. Now, while we advocate for adequate higher education funding, we're also developing new models ourselves that combine more efficiencies and new partnerships, because we know in the long term we cannot depend on the state. It's obvious by now. This approach also requires new thinking about federal and state deregulation and accountability. I have heard from many places that you need to run like a business. It doesn't bother me. We do need to run more like a business. But if the state wants us to operate more like a business, don't tie our hands behind our backs. Give us at least some freedom to be able to run more efficiently. Because a lot of the things that we do is not because we want them to do, it's because it's mandated by federal and state regulations. I think that how we respond to the current challenges will have a very, very real implications on the future of this university, and we all have a role to play. The university and the sister institutions in Illinois, all elected representatives have a role to play, as well as the citizens of Illinois have a role to play. I don't think that the legislators or the governor had a mandate to defund higher education this year. And I think the citizens of Illinois have to have a voice in this process. We all should be held accountable for our actions or inactions at the end, because at the end, the consequences of damaging the state's higher education system will affect all of us. We're moving ahead with strategic priorities as well, and I wanted to let you know that I'm not taking this lightly. We have a task force charged with looking into the future of innovative teaching, world-class research and community engagement to help us develop plans and measurable goals that will improve the student experience and success. As we educate, and I say this to all the student groups and parents that they meet us, we're trying to do two things. We are educating citizens for the 21st century, and at the same time, we prepare top-notch professionals. We also want to design and implement plans and goals that will demonstrate and enhance the local and global impact of our research, and plans and goals that will broaden and deepen our engagement in Chicago. This task force presented their first draft of their report this past Thursday to a large audience inside the university and was very well accepted, and there were many recommendations that they were made. I have also put together a resource strategy team that is taking a critical look at all of our operations. And their task force has been charged to make recommendations on how to improve our services. How can we make the most efficient use of our resources? Because in some cases, we are the worst enemies of ourselves. We have services here that instead of providing services, they become the worst regulators than the state or the federal government. And there are other teams that are working on more specific but critically important issues. We're putting an enrollment management plan together. We're putting a facilities master plan together, looking 10 years into the future of what this campus will look like. What they did in 1991 with the South Campus was visionary. We're still paying the price for it, but I'm happy to pay the price for it because it was visionary. It transformed that side of the campus.
And we need this vision for the future. We need to ask the question, how big is going to be this university and what will it look like and how are we going to build it? And we are also having a special team looking into the success of African-American students in particular, because we have left this segment of the population behind us in Chicago, in UIC. So all of them are going to be putting their reports up in the next couple of months and define where we need to go. But despite all of these challenges, I'm optimistic about the future of UIC. There's no doubt in my mind that quality, innovation, and location are on our side and will continue to serve us well. We have a new leadership team in place that understands the potential of this university and wants to set the standard for higher education during the 21st century. I keep telling everybody that our students are the faces of the future of this country. That's what America is going to look like in 30 years from now. And I think also our staff and the faculty are fully dedicated to their success and are fully dedicated to creating the knowledge that fuels both the economy and the culture of this country. This is a combination that, in my opinion, will not only prevail but will triumph under the current conditions that we have. It's an honor for me and a privilege to serve as UIC's Chancellor during what I believe is a very exciting new phase in the university's evolution. I want to thank you for all that you have done and you continue to do to support the University of Illinois at Chicago and moving upward and fast. Remember the title, you are still UIC. You have no choice, and we have no choice either. We need you. So, happy to see you here today, demonstrating your commitment by your presence. And if there are a few questions, do you have time? I know we run a little bit over and I see food is ready, probably. So, but I'll be happy to take a couple of them.
Well, thank you.
I'm Mark Resnick, physiology and biophysics. I'm still here.
Yep.
Retired. And still generating indirect costs for you. So, but the question I have really relates, it takes off from the last word you used, or just about the last, which was demonstrate. And as a undergraduate who finished in 1971, I certainly remember demonstrations well. When we would close a street, for example, we clearly inconvenienced some people, but we said at the time that it was too important. You know, that this war, I know Bernie Sanders thinks that Iraq was the biggest foreign policy blunder, but Vietnam is, clearly. And that war was something that we all had to bring to people's mind. This budget crisis is something that we have to bring to people's mind as well. And the idea that I don't hear is that we're all Chicago State. One of the things that I said when our dean was by, and I mean this seriously, is that maybe we should start canceling commencement and send diplomas by, as PDFs, and say to the parents, this is too important for you not to be involved. What kind of action can we take to make people realize that we've got to get a governor to stop campaigning and start governing and start to get a state to move forward?
We have to walk a fine line, and I think you hit it right on the nail in the following sense. One of the questions that I have been asked more than once, several times, by legislators, on both sides, by the way, is if things are bad, Chancellor, where is the outrage? Why don't we see an outrage? And what we saw last week is because of a crisis, there was some resolution. Politicians are used to prevail through crisis, or actually backtrack in a crisis, because that gives them the coverage that they want. The problem is that our instincts are exactly the opposite. In higher education, we're trying to avoid a crisis, because there is reputational costs that are strongly associated with the crisis, that they linger for a long period of time. If we cancel commencement, if we close classrooms for a period of time, remember, this is no longer 1971. In 1971, in-state students were 100% of the population, and nobody,
Very few people actually would go out of state and they would go to small private schools. One of the trends that concerns me this year, specifically this year, is that the requests for assistance from the state, from the graduating high school class, are down by 10%. Why? They're fleeing. They're moving out of state. Those who can afford to go out of state this year are going out of state. And we'll see the effects in enrollments all across the state because they don't trust the system and there's mobility in the students. Iowa, Missouri, Indiana are recruiting right now in Illinois, offering in-state tuition for our students. So if we are going to show this image that we are in desperate need, right, and we really shutting down, we may shoot ourselves in the foot. So I have seen the higher education community struggle for the last 10 months in the state, trying to balance on one hand some level of confidence that we have to project, and on the other hand some sense of emergency that we have to project. You can criticize and you can say, well, we didn't walk the fine line well, because look where we are today, and we haven't achieved what we needed to achieve. Well, you know, you can play Monday morning quarterback. I'm kind of a Monday morning quarterback, quite frankly, because the load of the advocacy part falls on the president of the system. In fact, we have been asked to kind of stay at the background while the president of the system advocates for the entire system, right? Makes sense, because he has stronger numbers to present. He can talk about 80,000 students. He can talk about a much broader statewide presence. I'm not giving you an answer, a straight answer, because there's no straight answer. It's a balance act.
So I have a question. You mentioned that our hands are tied by state mandates and regulations, and maybe that was okay when we were, this is my words, not yours, when we were being fully funded, but now we're in this position of being told what to do and not giving the resources to do it. When I meet with my legislators, I got the specific question, what mandates and regulations can they put through to our legislator specifically that would save money and make things work better?
We prepared a book because Governor Rauner, the first time that I met with him, asked me exactly the same question. Right? That was last April, 1 year ago. He said, Governor will be very happy to give you specific examples, and it's not only legislative measures, they're executive orders in some cases, that you don't even need the legislature in order to repeal or issue new executive orders. We gave them a book. If there was true interest in changing the bureaucracy, a lot of things could have changed between
right.
April and
so I would ask.
So I'll be happy. I'll be
so
happy
give
to give you
a copy of the book.
Yeah, we'll
and
be
that
happy
is
to give
something
you a copy of the book.
SUAA can pick up, and perhaps we can reach out. We have 1,600 members in our UIC chapter. There are 16,000 statewide living in every district. And then we have
and it
UIC
includes a broad range of procurement issues, personnel issues, capital, infrastructure issues. It's a broad range of issues.
Thank you.
And some of them are important issues. I'm not saying that they're not important, but just to have to deal with several levels makes life miserable. Just to give you a very sensitive example, right? Sexual assault on campus is an extremely sensitive and important issue. It's something that we need to deal with. But we don't need different regulations from the state, the federal level, in some cases, contradicting each other. Right? That's part of the problem. It's the framework that we operate is just very difficult to navigate.
We can help.
So,
yeah, we can help.
You have time in your hands, and you're dangerous because you have time in your hands.
You talked about unifying the campus, and I have a lot of concern about our Springfield campus, and it's really been a third sort of rated experience there, and they have very good long distance learning, and I know at one point we tried to resurrect the global campus and that, and I have no idea why they didn't go to our Springfield campus as the leader. I mean, because they actually have the expertise. So I want to know what you're doing to bring them online along with the others.
Well, we have programs that help us collaborate between the three different universities. I'm of the opinion that we are three separate universities. We are part of a system, but we are not three campuses of one university. This model was tried under President Hogan and failed miserably. And you know the outcomes of what has happened. We are three independently accredited, different. Part of the reason that the model of trying to call this one university with three different campuses has failed is because we are very different. Our students are very different than the students at Urbana-Champaign. Our research enterprises at Chicago and Urbana are very different than Springfield. So we are very different institutions, and we need to be given the flexibility to do what we can and what we should for our own constituencies separately from each other. At the same point, you're right to point out that there may be efficiencies and maybe opportunities when we take advantage of each other, right? Of what we have. That's a natural process. You cannot enforce collaboration if the incentives, if it's not a win-win situation for both. We are working fairly well with the other two chancellors, very well, I would argue, to identify areas where there is opportunity for both of us. Distance education is one of them. Yes, indeed, Springfield has a good reputation.